Zoning Board of Appeals, City of Northampton. I am chairing this evening, Sarah Northrup. We have Carolyn Mish, our staff from the Planning Department, Bob Riddle, Barry Smith, and Elizabeth Silver. First, we start with open public comment on any item that is not officially on the agenda. There is none, so noted. We now open the public hearing on special permit for an additional directional sign for New England Treatment Access, number 118 Con Street, map ID 39A, lot 20. Through the applicant, would you please present and state your name and address?
Yes.
For the record?
My name is Leslie Tar Laurie. I live at 113 Packardville Road in Pelham, Massachusetts. I'm the Western Regional Director for New England Treatment Access, which is located at 118 Con Street. And what I've come tonight to ask is, we do have one directional signal sign, which isn't a lighted sign, just a sign, on Con Street, which is part of what we're allowed. And in order to have a second sign, what we needed to do was to come before you for a special permit. And the sign is a duplicate of the sign that we have on Con Street. We would like it on Pleasant Street, because where the location of the facility is one which it seems to be difficult for people to find. It's right next to where Pleasant Journeys is. It's the small Fulton Street street. And so that's what we're just asking. And that's what I hope you'll say yes to tonight.
Thank you. Do we have any comments from DPW?
No.
Any questions from the board?
This sign says it's going to be backlit. What does that mean?
It isn't actually backlit. It's just how can I describe it? You don't really see it at night. It's just dark. It's not lit.
So it's lit from surrounding light?
Correct.
That you don't provide?
Correct.
So also, it says it's going to be 12 square feet, and then it's going to be 4 feet high and 3 feet wide. How high is the sign going to be? I mean, is it going to be standing higher than that on a pedestal?
No, it's actually, that's the whole sign.
That's the
sign,
whole sign is going to be actually, it's just going to sit on the ground 4 feet high, four feet off the ground, 3 feet wide.
Correct. Should I stand up? Is that the proper way to do this or no?
It doesn't matter. this is our, so our copy shows this. The diagram of Pleasant Street is pretty illegible. This is just a photocopy. So it's just this thing standing there.
Exactly. And it's because it is tall, there was a ditch, a small ditch that needed to be will need to be dug for this in order for it to sit solidly. And what we were able to do through the Department of Public Works was to actually, there are limitations as to when you're allowed to dig. So we were able to dig and put a plug in it. And if you say yes, we can put the sign in. If not, we'll fill in the ditch.
What do you mean a plug?
I'm calling it a plug. I'm sure there's some fancier name for it. It's actually a wooden piece, so that it was a safety issue, so that no one would trip or
in the hole.
Right. And it was visible enough. So and I have a picture of it if you needed to see that, but it was visible enough so no one would trip.
So will there be a concrete base? What's holding this thing up?
It's actually all one piece that's actually put into the ground, and it's the material that's described in the application is what it is. And again, it's a duplicate of what was already accepted with the site plan review. It's just a duplicate of that one, but just on the other side.
What I don't know, but what I don't understand is, if this is the sign, I don't understand, what are people looking for?
So what it is that they don't, and Google Maps, I'm sorry to say, hasn't been helpful with this. They make people go round and round and round. And what people don't see is Fulton Street. So what this does is, on one side, this is the one which is, you know, so if you're coming from, if you're on, coming from Pleasant Street, as if you're going to 91, what you're gonna see is this sign. So again,
the lower
pretty,
one?
This lower one. So it's like telling you, you could go this way. And on Conn Street, there's one which is very similar to this one, and it makes you think you're, you know, if you want to go in, you can go that way. And there is one sign which we were allowed, both by the city and the Department of Public Health, which is a larger sign, but it's actually right as you come into the driveway. And so for many, if they're not looking, they just don't see it.
So people know what N-E Pine Tree A means?
For people who, well, hopefully before long, everyone will know it's NETA. So it's supposed to be a T.
Okay.
So it's New England Treatment Access. But that's the logo and symbol. And what we're also trying to do is to not, you know, there are very many restrictions as to what, how advertising can happen. So we've been very discreet, would be the way that I would say it. So people know the logo. Or the hope will be before long, most will know the logo.
Is they, are they coming for set appointments?
Actually, we don't have appointments. We're, we more like what I kind of think of as more like a CVS. So in the same way that you would come and pick up a prescription and you don't have an appointment, what you're able to do is to just come and, you know, show your identification, show your card that affords you the ability to come in, and then you can come in. But
so
again, no appointments.
If every person had telephone contact before coming, then they would have been, had a little more direction on how to get there. But since there is kind of, it's kind of a walk-in kind of.
And also, I have to say, there are, because at this point we are the only dispensary in Western Mass, some are coming from distances outside of Northampton. You know, some actually even from the east, even if their dispensary is there, they feel like this one is the one that they want to come to. But just in Western Mass, some, you know, someone comes from North Adamson. This is a part of town that I have to say is one where people are used to just zipping through. And so it's like, take your breath and, you know, see where we are. But I can't tell you how many calls I've gotten where it's, someone is literally at the liquor store, which is behind where the dispensary is, and it's like, I don't know where you are. Like, look across the street.
No.
That wouldn't help with that sign, but yeah.
Now, when is the roundabout going to go, or is it still going?
Oh yeah, next year they're going to start construction.
So that'll affect this too, right?
No, I mean, it'll affect it in that cars will slow down before they get to this, so they might be able to see the signs more.
Okay. Thank you. No question?
Okay, motion to close.
So moved.
Do you want me to do this and you do the next?
Sure. Okay, these two will be voting.
All right, did you motion to close?
Motion to close, yes.
Second.
All in favor? Okay, public hearing is closed. Any further discussion or anyone want to frame a motion on the application?
No, sure. I move that we approve a special permit for an additional directional sign for the New England Treatment Access at 118 Conn Street, map ID 39A-20.
Second.
All those in favor? And passes.
Wonderful. Thank you so much.
Yep.
And I think you've this back to you. I think this is your.
It's mine.
Oh, sorry. Excuse me.
If you want it, I'm going to recite it.
Is it something I want to read?
Is it something you want?
Okay. All right. Thanks again. Thank you so much.
Tom Michael, next.
Thank you. Thank you. I will now, let's see now, we went through that. I'll now open the public hearing on special permit for the appeal of the, excuse me, sorry, not special permit. Opening the hearing for the appeal of building commissioner's determination on zoning permit for a single-family house at 1 Garfield Ave, Florence, map ID 17D 81. So we will hear from the applicant. Please state your name and address for the record.
I need to bring some materials in.
Okay. That's why I asked. How far are you going? Applicant has left the room. For the record. Nope, there he is. And he's bringing in a great. Yes, yes. What are your intentions here? We usually just get a verbal outline of the application.
I can't just do a verbal outline. There's too many pictures to show.
Before you begin, may I ask you one thing?
Sure.
You have given us an enormous amount of material.
Which we've read.
A lot of which doesn't seem to be terribly relevant. What I would like you to do, if you would please, sir, is give us a precise statement of exactly what it is in the building inspector's determination that you're appealing from, so that you can
because of the way the letter was written, it's debatable, and that's why we need to talk about all the details of it.
No.
Okay.
I think I'd like to know first, what are you appealing from? We have two letters from the building inspector, and what is it that you're taking issue with?
Well,
could you refer to his letter?
Sure. Okay. So first of all, there's two letters. There was one dated September 24th that was sent to me, was never sent to me actually, which I picked up on September 30th. There's another one also dated September 24th, which was not written on September 24th. It was written in October. You'll see that one.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Again, tell us. Look,
so that one was written in October, so that's a little bit of an issue that they wrote.
Are you appealing from both of these, or are you appealing?
I am a naive person who bought this lot, and all I tried to do was find out what the zoning parameters were for this property.
Look, I do understand, but you also have to understand our difficulty. You know, we're ordinary people in the community.
Zoning board denied my zoning permit application, and I'm appealing that denial.
Which, I mean, I don't think we've never heard an application.
Let me set up a little background. Usually a procedure would be we have a two-page permit application.
Correct.
And which there's an attempt to summarize it and keep it concise. Do we have any comments from DPW or any other public? No, there was no other input. So you know that we all received the information, and I believe we've all actually gone through it.
I will take a step back. There was just the information from the building commissioner that was sent to you.
Right, thank you. Went through, weeded out the, okay, there's the ordinance, that's familiar with that, so here's the sections, and try to sort it out a bit. It becomes a bit heavy with repetitive emails, so it is helpful when you can summarize it for us a bit. Because what happens is that in enforcement, I know it's a complicated case, we want to simplify the answer, and whether it's figuring out exactly what you need that's different from what's been presented, but this is all we have to go on. So I'll let you do a presentation, but I think we do have a concern that it we don't want to, we're not going to read every page for a couple hours. We will.
No, it's not a couple hours.
Okay. I'm going to let him proceed.
Ask one clarifying question just before we.
Of the applicant?
Yeah, before we get started, or
sure.
But I saw two zoning permit applications. One was September 1st that requested a single family home with an accessory apartment and a detached garage. And then there was another one on October 9th, same year, for a single family home with accessory apartment less than 900 square feet. Which one are we proceeding on tonight?
It's kind of a long story. I believe it's the one submitted on September 1st is the one.
The one for the detached garage. Is that right? Is that?
I just want to, these are slides in case you want to look at any of that, in case you can't see or anything like that.
But there's also sort of a permit application from October 14th of this year.
Yes, I need to, I think it would be best if you just let me.
No. I hate to be
it's
difficult,
the one with
Mr.
the
Mitchell.
Garage attached, yeah. Not detached.
That's detached. The,
I have no idea as yet what it is that we're considering.
This is the one that was denied. That's what was denied. Yeah. I thought it was the one that this is not attached. This one.
So this is the one we're talking about. This is a house, it's got a detached garage. It has a minimum of 5 feet between the two structures so that satisfies that requirement.
Back up,
of the
which application is this for?
September 1st.
And that's detached garage.
Detached garage, yeah. Correct. So this is the lot that we're talking about. It's called Lot 1A here. The frontage here is L3, and that was set by you guys in the comprehensive permit at 25 feet. Okay, that's L3 here. So that makes L4 and this one side yard, and L33 and this one side yard, and this is the rear. Okay. So one of the reasons I included a lot of the original land records was because I did some research to see sort of how this project proceeded. And the initial thing was that it had two family homes for Habitat for Humanity, and one was being sold separately as a market value. And then lot 1B was also going to be one, but it turned out there was, I think, too much wetland in there. And so they incorporated that lot into the conservation area. But then what happened was that when they did that, and in fact the frontage listed on the comprehensive permit application is 37 feet. Because, and they had the hammerhead in here to make it so that that other one could get the frontage. But what they ended up doing was actually putting a curve in the road. Okay, and so while initially this was all frontage on my property, this net piece now became side yard. And because that became side yard, this yellow area here now becomes developable property.
And okay.
Subject to the side yard setback, not subject to the front setback. Because the only frontage is this 25-foot frontage, according to your 2004 decision. So you guys put the lot up for sale. I guess you let planning do all this stuff. Came up with this great thing, the Small Lots, Big Ideas program. They put out an RFP for architects. There were 19 architects.
I want to interrupt one thing. You're saying the setbacks. Sort of there, you're saying that the, if you put a house on that, that the...
Let me go back to this one. See, in the original one, the frontage.
Where do you think the side setback should be?
Pardon me?
Where are the side setbacks?
What do you mean, where are they?
That is, are they? Do they go to the north and the south, or do they go to the east and the west?
Well, they go from a parallel line into from wherever the side is, I assume. I mean, I don't know.
Well, that looks like the front of the lot to me.
For this one, it is. This is the original intent when the road was straight and they were still thinking of including lot one. That was what it looked like originally.
Is this...
Yes, that's the.
Okay. So we're trying to kind of get at the gist of what it is that we can help with.
Okay. Well, it's complicated.
Yep.
Because it is because it was a 2004 permit, and I'm still covered under the 2004 zoning. It makes it so that I have to comply to the 2004 zoning. All of those zoning attributes, and I have to know what they are, which I haven't been able to find out. That's one of the things I'm here for. In order to do that, I have to, you know what the parameters are. That's what I need to do to build the house.
So I'm gonna let you continue. There's a whole handful of assumptions which are that you've had to make in trying to sort this out.
Correct.
And I'm just kind of weighing, okay, where do we, so Carolyn and Bob and I have all been around that long, and she's of course very familiar with the process and what happened with the frontages and all that. We're just trying to keep it manageable, so.
Well, I said it would be less than an hour, and it will be.
Okay.
So anyway, the city put up this Big Lots Small Ideas program, and in that program, they used a lot of designs to use to sell the property. They had a big week-long thing at 8th Gallery, and they had a lot of different kinds of designs. You can see they had ones with three-story things here. They had ones with inverted roofs. They had one with flat tops. Ones with tons of shed roofs. Here's a four-story thing.
It was very exciting.
Here was the winner. Okay. A very nice house, but really not harmonious with the neighborhood. You know, all the habitat houses have 8-on-10 pitch roofs. They're all gables. They all have, they don't have metal siding and things like that. Here's a UMass one.
You're right, 10, 12.
This one from UMass is interesting because it has two buildings. So it was exciting, and I was excited, and I met Wayne Feiden, and I was like, you can build all this stuff? And he's like, yeah, you can build all that. And so I was excited. Here's just some examples of the designs. So the question about the garage, why do I want a garage? And the main reason that I want a garage is because if you look, I took and went to every, and why the assessment data is in there, is I took the assessment of every house on Garfield Avenue, and I looked at the ones that had a garage, and I took the mean value, and that was 292,000, and I took a look at all the houses without the garages, and I took a mean value of them, and then it was $186,000. So the garage difference is $106,000, which is a significant amount of difference. Now, I'm not saying if a realtor was gonna like look at a house and say it's a garage, oh, it's gonna be 100,000 more. That's a ridiculous premise. You know, 10,000, 20,000, but it does add value. And that's an important thing for me. Okay.
I'm just having difficulty seeing what relevance that is to the question as to whether Mr. Hasbrook overstepped his authority in making his determination. So if you could hew to that issue, I should be very grateful.
Okay, well, let's find out how you find out setbacks in this town. So the first thing that you do is you contact the building department, and they tell you that, or actually, I looked at the RFP that you gave to the people, and they said it's 15 feet in the front, 15 in the back, and 10 on the sides, December 2013. Then in January 2014, Mr. Feiden reports that no, it's actually 15 foot size, so the red part shows my lot shrinking. Then in July, Carolyn Mish reports that no, it's actually 20 foot rear, 15 foot side, and 15 foot front. And then later in July, she says, oh, wait a minute, there's a wetland there. Now it's 40 feet behind, 40 foot. Then I sent Wayne mail. And he got Carolyn to send me mail, and now she's saying that it's 10 feet in the front, 10 feet on the side, and 10 feet in the rear. So blue shows me giving me more than I should have. And then finally, Wayne sends me another email saying this is actually what it is, okay? Then in the rejection letter from Lewis, he refers to the cluster, and in that case, the front is zero, the side is 15, and the back is 20, surrounded by red.
Sorry, which letter can we...
In the letter, he refers to
which
there's
one?
Some
September,
attachments to
September 24th,
number two. There are two September 24ths.
They're not different, are they?
Yeah, they are. They're significantly different. And one was written in September 24th. One was written in late October. It's just dated September 24th.
Well, then I would like to have some clarification from Mr. Hasbrook as to, if you like, which is the operative letter from September 24th.
I appealed the letter, the first letter.
The one that you gave us, I take it.
The letter that, the operative letter in this case is a two-page letter dated September 24th. It includes two pages of attachments.
Mm-hmm. I'm referring to those attachments, but that letter is not the letter. That letter was never sent to me on September 24th. That letter was I received on October 30th. And that letter was not written on September 24th. It was written in October.
I'm not sure what difference that makes. It's not as though there's statute of limitation problems here.
Well, I feel like there have been, and they've been messed with.
So we want to have something that we can sort out. And I understand that this was very confusing, and that may
I'm going to get
obviously
into the letter more,
okay,
if you'll let me proceed
right
forward.
And the issue with what the setbacks actually are.
So I still don't know what the setbacks are.
Okay.
I thought I knew in September when I got that. I'm a math guy, so I do it by the mode. I got two of the same thing, so that's what I'm going with. So the next thing is, though, they're not actually going to tell me Wayne Biden isn't going to tell me what the zoning setbacks are. Now he tells me that I have to apply for a permit to find out what the zoning setbacks are. So I do that. I start to apply for a permit. So I had already been doing a lot of work on my architecture. I had this thing called a functional diagram, and I created a house out of it quickly in SketchUp, and I just threw it together. And I used one of the big ideas, small lots of big ideas, this one here, where it had two separate structures, and to get some space between it, and to have some airflow, and she calls it more life-affirming. And that was my goal when I bought this property, was to build a house for myself and for my boys, and to have a great time building a house. I built a house before, and I had a great experience. Was good friends with Stanley Sadowski. He and my son were pals, and it was such a different experience. So anyway, my plan that I did is reflective of one of the concepts that you presented in when you made this thing for sale. I mean, this was supposed to showcase what you can do with the new zoning, okay? I see this as very similar, except that this is more harmonious because it has the same roof pitches and the same kind of materials.
So before you move on, the one on the left was the proposed design, and the one on the right is your design, is that correct?
Correct. So when I'm about to submit the zoning permit, Wayne sends me an email saying that he's decided that he doesn't think I might have a right to submit a zoning permit because of a deed writer that I have that says I have to work with an architect when I'm designing my house. Well, I'm sitting here going, I don't even know what the setbacks are. I'm not going to go to an architect and spend thousands of dollars and then have him come back and say, oh, you can't build that. So the next thing that was a roadblock in this was there was no response in the 30-day deadline. So I went to Lewis, and I picked up my permit on the 30th, and we had a very problematic conversation. First, he started off and he accused me of withholding information from my permit, which is not true. And then he threatened to fine me. He claimed that he sent me a letter on September 25th, the one dated September 24th. That never arrived. And then at the end of the conversation, he said he was only going to communicate by letter, but he would send me a letter detailing the appeals process, and that letter never arrived. So one of the things, and the most disturbing thing really of all that he said, was he said that he is totally inclined to, at this point, to believe that we have an antagonistic relationship. All I did was my picked up my zoning permit. I really didn't think that was appropriate. So anyway, in the exchange of emails with Wayne Feynman, one of the things he said that Lewis would do in his denial was be specific about where it doesn't need zoning and how to comply.
May I just interrupt?
Yes.
Yes. I'm looking at the November 5th letter.
That's not related to this.
What do you mean it's not related to it? It's sort of definitely was written in response to your application?
It was written in response to a different application, not this application.
Which application do I
have? I have 9 applications pending.
Oh.
You have 9 applications pending. Okay, well, until you get to know, one of the things that this letter says is that there are certain things that you have to go through according to the Homeowners Association declaration. You've got to submit a plot plan of the lot showing the location of the proposed construction, building plans including drawings which show the elevations of the proposed construction, a description of exterior materials and colors, and the lot owner's proposed construction schedule. Now, do you disagree with that?
No, I'm trying to get the setbacks for my lot.
Well, then why don't you go through and do the steps that Mr. Hasbrook is suggesting are necessary according to the Homeowners Association declaration.
Well, number one, the homeowners declarations are covenants, okay? And it's my understanding that covenants are not enforceable by the city. That is an agreement among the homeowners that we have.
I don't believe that
is necessarily an enforceable thing, but sure, I will do that. I will gladly do that.
Well, then why aren't we sort of in a way here too soon? Why don't you go through all of that, submit it to Mr. Hasbrook?
I was told by Mr. Pill that I will lose my right to a garage if I don't appeal this, so that's why I'm here appealing this.
If if you sort of then have him submit your applications, sort of, and then if he denies that, that is when you've gone through these things that
well,
are
required. Well, I think
required,
you need to hear more about the denial then.
Then you can bring it.
Let me finish with my presentation and then you can get more answers about this.
So I'm just finding this very frustrating.
So here's another rule of law. Here is the first rejection letter. Remember, Wayne Fiden said he would be specific, but he wasn't specific. He used the word several criteria, and then he didn't say which ones. And then he used the term harmonious relationship, which is a subjective thing. And this isn't really supported by the public. I've talked to a bunch of people, including my neighbor Kim here, and she feels that that's totally harmonious. And then finally the letter referred me back to planning again. So I went around to my neighbors and I said, I went with something like this. And I was like, do you feel like this is less harmonious than the ones that they used to advertise this great new zoning? And they all said no, and they signed a petition that said it. And they didn't mind having a garage in the location that was placed. So there's really no public support for this position. So as you got to, I did go to talk to Wayne Fiden, and he told me that he believed that this one of these designs, this courthouse design, is more harmonious than this design. And that kind of got my shackles up a little bit. And he also told me that he had no knowledge of the zoning permit denial. And he states that the designs were only conceptual, not necessarily buildable, which contradicts what he said when he was putting them up for sale.
May I suggest that comments made in the course sort of negotiations before that are not really a part of the zoning inspector's determination. So far as we know, there are only two things that are relevant to the zoning inspector's determination. And that is the letter of September 24th and the letter of November 5th.
Okay, sure. So
please leave
that. So the letter of September 24th, which one? Because I want to start calling that the letter of October 24th.
Is that when you received it?
No, that's when it was written.
I must say, so far as I'm concerned, Mr. Hasbrook tells us that the one that was taken off the website, that there was an email.
So this is
okay. Let's take a look at. Let's read that letter. Let's read one section of this.
Is this the letter you're talking about?
No, I'm talking about the second letter.
Why does this one say September 24th?
There are two that say September 24th.
That's a hazard of having so much paper to sort through which is which.
Can I interject and just clarify a couple of things? It is true there was some back and forth about setbacks because the zoning had changed since 2004, and we now allow a lesser front setback than we did at that time. So basically, whatever the permit that was granted, the comprehensive permit, is allowed or the current zoning.
That's what? Not what I was told that it was grandfathered to the 2004 zoning.
What exactly were the requirements then for setback, and what are they now?
So they were waived. So you typically, there's a 15-foot side setback. It's less for a cluster. It's 10 feet on each side for a cluster development. At that point, the standard setbacks were 15 feet. So cluster, you get a little bit less. And then the lot did change.
Be considered a cluster,
right?
In 2004,
right.
Okay,
so
the actual setback requirements then were 10 feet.
Right, and then the lot did change size, it changed size because there were more wetlands in the back, and the city thought it would be better to give a buildable section instead of including wetlands, so they would become protected, so that's why it got smaller, and so the comp permit was amended. The other thing I just want to clarify is no one's saying that there's no garage allowed, but the design that was submitted in the comp permit, the concept design, showed a front of a house with a front door facing the front of the street face. And so that's what the issue is with this particular application. So there's nothing that says you can't have a garage on the side or the back or incorporate as part of the front, as long as it doesn't I mean, that would require an amendment of the comp permit, but there's been no outright denial of a garage per se.
It's just because of the location in relation
exactly,
to the street.
The design and the layout, right.
So, can I just ask you a question?
Yeah.
Perhaps in order to facilitate this, and again, we're not going to interrupt your presentation, but is there a way that it would be possible for you to move the garage so that it doesn't violate the setback and the location issues that, well, not the setback,
there
just
are
the
no
location.
Setbacks.
Yeah, that's right. I'm sorry, I stand corrected. The location issues that seem to be the crux of this appeal.
Did you read what I wrote in my thing? I wrote that I want a short driveway. I don't want a long driveway. And there's economic reasons why I don't want a long driveway. And here's the economic reason. The reason is that there's an open space requirement, which is, this is the smallest lot in town, okay? And it's a 65% open space. That means I have 35% to develop my open space. 35%. That's 1,806 square feet on this lot. If I take a driveway and I make a 40-foot driveway, that takes away from my open space requirement. It makes it so that the footprint of my house has to be smaller because I have to meet that open space requirement. So effectively, by forcing me to put the garage further away from the road, you're saying that my property has less value.
Well said. I understand that argument. I'm looking at this thinking the action that this is my understanding. The action that was taken that you're appealing is, I have a sheet here. It says following action has been taken on this application. And I want to make sure I'm talking about, we're talking about, you said there's 9 pending, so I don't want to bring any of those other ones in to this. So there's this particular one that you're, that you put in, and it's dated October 15th, and it says that additional permits are required, which is an amendment of the comprehensive permit. Now, is there an additional denial?
That's why I'm saying that letter was not written on September 24th, because the explanation for all of those ones that were submitted in October is in that letter dated September 24th. I know that it wasn't written until October 22nd.
Okay.
At the
so maybe the date is wrong.
And it really came about because I filed my appeal paperwork. And when they read the appeal paperwork and it said Lewis wasn't specific about it, he had to go and sit down and be specific.
So I want to clarify what it is that, you know, we'd like to see something happen in
your
lot.
I still feel like I would like to finish my presentation because.
All right.
I'm really not ready. You need to know more. There's more to know.
We will let you proceed.
So
for a while,
in that letter, which responds to all of the other permits, but also responds to this one that were relevant, Lewis makes claims that are just not true. First of all, he says that you can't see the front of the house from the street. Well, you can see the front of the house from the street. That's number one. Number two, he says there's no other garages that block the view of the front of the house. And that's not true. That's 15 square feet of that. And the third thing that he says is the houses are primarily located on the street. The average setback of a house on Garfield Avenue is 45 feet. My plan is 37 feet, 8 feet less. And I do want to know, there is a flag lot on there, which has a 250 foot, but I took that out. It was 55, but 45 is...
May I just clarify one thing, since you're accusing him of saying something that's false?
Sure.
He says here, the existing houses on Garfield Avenue are predominantly located close to the street. Only one has a garage in front of the house. That garage is set into a slope and does not block the view of the house from the street.
Right, there it
is. So he said, there's one, yeah. You said there weren't
any. He says it does not. He says the view does not block that, and it does block the view from the street. I'm showing you a picture of the
view
from the street.
Well, when I walked past it, it didn't seem to, but that's, but go on.
Mine doesn't either. Mine doesn't block the view in front of the house. So talking about moving things up, as she was talking about moving things up to the 2014 zoning, one of the things that they had in the 2014 zoning is a facade calculation for the garage, and there's a maximum percentage that the garage is allowed to be, which is 30%. This wasn't part of the 2004 stuff, but part of the 2014. So it's really not applicable to the situation. But just to know that my garage is 270 square feet, the house facade was 756, and that comes in at a 27%, which is actually less than 30. And then there's this problem that I have with how I've been communicated with. So here's my permit application, 65 North Main Street. Here's the order to remove that they said when they made me move the trailer.
I don't think this is relevant to the...
I think it's relevant because they have... I don't. Okay, great. I'll skip it. So, as I said, I have applied for eight more permits because I'm not understanding the meaning of harmonious. And so I want to let you know that this Santa Barbara one was accepted even though it's pink and has terracotta and a shed roof and doesn't fit in the neighborhood. This one was rejected. I don't know. They didn't really give a reason why. Now this is the same design as that other one, except instead of having a shed there, it's got a PV, ground PV mounted thing, and that was accepted. I don't know why. This one may accept, rejected. Not really sure. It hasn't really clarified what it means to be harmonious. So, I talked about the covenants, that the covenants are not really enforceable. The 2004 comprehensive permit, that's the thing to go on, and he used the right language of harmonious and all that I'm totally in agreement with. I just don't agree with the interpretation of it. I don't believe that what I did was not harmonious. Here's what I'm irritated about with the city. Okay, the city has made threats of fines to me. They've forced me to communicate by letter. They make statements like life would be easier or avoid aggravation, as if what I'm trying to do, which is just get the setbacks for my lot, as if I don't deserve that. And then the language in these letters is very unspecific. It's hard to figure out what he's talking about. He says a number of designs, I don't know which ones, many of them, or others, et cetera, things like that. You can't figure out what he's trying to say.
Do you know the setbacks now?
No.
What the setbacks are?
No.
You don't know what the setbacks
are? No. I've tried for a year and a half to find out what the setbacks are, and I still don't know what they are.
Are there setbacks for this?
No one will tell me what they are. That's what I wrote.
The setback on the front is 10. That's what the current zoning is. So even if the comp permit had 15 feet as the front setback, it would be 10.
You can use 10 if you wish.
Right.
Instead of 15, you can use 10, so it's bigger.
And the rear, there may still be a wetlands issue because it depends on how close you get to the wetlands. It's a local jurisdiction, so that's going to depend on where it's sited.
I'm talking about zoning, not wetlands. There are wetland setbacks, but that is not a zoning setback, and I think that's been confusing for the applicant.
Okay.
What's the zoning setback?
And then on the side, I believe, I should have written this down for this one, I believe it's 10 feet, because that was the cluster setback.
10 feet on each side.
Mm-hmm. But I'm just going to double check that.
What did you assume that the setbacks were on each side?
I didn't know because I got so many different reports that I was really confused. And I was really confused because the design showed so many different things. But some, you know, one person showed only in the area like this guy, he
was worried about the wetland. So, mm-hmm. So he put it all in there, and then he had to make it four stories high.
Yeah. Now, that doesn't tell
none of these these designs were interesting, and they were presented.
They were presented to sell the lot.
But they're not relevant to our determination.
No, they weren't presented to sell the lot. They were presented as part of a fun design competition.
They were used to advertise the lot for sale. Absolutely. The real estate broker is here. I'm sure she can vouch that these were
clarify used. That by pulling up the original, but they there was a whole process, and I know there was some specific language about how one, you don't have to build one of these, but you should use an architect, and then you're
but I would also would be able to build one of these if I wanted.
Not necessarily. Those were part of a design competition. They weren't all approved any architect could throw in some nice pictures. But then when they settled on something and some parameters,
right. Sure.
Maybe we need to look
clearly. But when they were shown, were there disclaimers shown that these things couldn't be built?
I don't believe they were.
And I don't see how this is in any way relevant to our...
He does have a point, which is we want to address your appeal of the commissioner's ruling, and in order to do that, what my understanding is that the commissioner's ruling was that there should be amendment of the comprehensive permit, and in which case...
I'm appealing the letter, the first letter that was sent on September 23rd, where there was no amendment to the comprehensive permit. He simply handed me a letter and said, go away.
Can we settle on the setbacks, please? We got away from that. What the setbacks
the
actually
setback in your, the setbacks are front 20, side 10.
No, front 10.
Front 10. Side.
This is the most advantageous, whether it was in the comprehensive permit or current.
Right.
Right.
The most advantageous for the lot owner is 10 feet front.
Right.
Right. Right.
And what is it in the rear? Without worrying about wetlands.
Yeah, I need to check. I think it's 15. The typical is 20. But because the lot was made smaller, there was some waiver for that, and I just want to double check the waiver language for the rear.
What waiver is that?
Under the comprehensive permit, zoning can be waived by the Zoning Board of Appeals. So then the permit would stand, the comprehensive permit that was recorded would stand.
There's no mention of setbacks for that lot in any of the comprehensive permits. There's only two mentions. There's the curb cut, and there's the 25-foot frontage.
So
what Wayne told me was that any parameters that aren't specifically specified in the comprehensive permit default to the 2004 zoning, which is why they were able to do the 10-foot side without a waiver. And that's noted in the comprehensive permit application. If you look, they say none. Mm-hmm. You know,
or
terms, so
if it's
in
more
the waiver column,
in the current zoning, you could use the current zoning.
Okay, so 10 feet is what we have now, right? So 10 feet front, 10 feet side, and the rear 20?
15. I think 15, that's what it says in the...
It is 15.
Okay.
So in any case.
So you have lots of room to build the house, and you have 10 permits in to...
Nine
for a design. So you're negotiating with someone for a design. Who's he negotiating with, Kelly?
We haven't seen a real design. We've just seen the concept drawings that are there. So it's hard to tell exactly how the orientation is and what the actual building is. But the original comprehensive permit also showed a concept layout for structures and houses. So if you want to vary from that and do something different that doesn't show a front entry facing the street, then that would be a comprehensive permit amendment. Whether or not that was initially described by the building commissioner, that's the process.
So there's some confusion, I think, about there was a whole bunch of designs presented as part of a competition, and then there were some designs that were possible under the comprehensive permit. And the comprehensive permit did technically allow those designs. Am I correct? Design concepts.
They were concepts, but nothing was approved. We didn't say you have to submit a concept that's approved under the current permit. There was no relationship of whether someone who did a design would get an automatic permit.
So, to put in the application for a building permit, one needs a full set of drawings, et cetera.
Right.
So the applications that you have pending, is each one of them a full plan that could be?
No, I was doing this to find out what my setbacks were.
So you know what your setbacks are now, right?
I do know what my setbacks are, but the problem is that this whole process has been poisoned for me. I have the building commissioner saying we have an antagonistic relationship, and that's somebody that I have to work with in the future. I have my contractors saying they're not interested in doing this project anymore because of the antagonism and the bad vibes. And so I'm looking to permit all of the ones that were designed, submitted to the design, so when I sell this, I can say that you can actually build these or not, because to advertise it as if you can build these and then to say you can't. And Wayne Fiden has an email where he says, oh yeah, you can build these. I have it in email. So you know, I don't know what you guys are saying.
So it sounds like you have, you may be preparing for, or you may have a case that would go to court. Our jurisdiction is pretty limited. It's about, it's looking at what the building commissioner, what it is exactly that he decided that didn't work for you. For a single application, if you were going to go through a building permit process for each of those designs, you'd have to have a full design that would be permittable. So that sounds expensive, but you have a project to do to work on that. So the aggravation and costs that you've put into this may be substantial, and we aren't the
carpenters,
officers that can help you with that.
I understand that, but this is a project that this board created as a sample of what you can do with the new zoning, for one thing, but also of clustered housing and how that's going to go forth. I know you have an Oak Street project coming up, and you need to learn from the mistakes that you made, for one thing. And there are definitely mistakes. There's a mistake that was made in between lots number 3 and 5, where they put a big jog into the property line. And what happens is that jog, they put a fence up. And so that fence now extends halfway into the backyard of number 3. And it just looks ridiculous, number 1. And then it's just too narrow. You know, they have a canopy, and the canopy at 5 is onto the property at 3. And it's
a lot
just
of
space,
and
the back,
yes,
of 3 is so close to 7 and 9.
Yeah.
You know, and once you gave up that lot, 1A, everything should have been shifted down by 15 feet, and it would have avoided so many problems.
So it may be true that that the comprehensive permit should be revisited. The problem we have is that we can only address this appeal of this particular ruling on this particular permit. We're not amending a comprehensive permit tonight. We're addressing an appeal. And like I said, it may be that amending the comprehensive permit would be the proper application for you to put in for an amendment to the comprehensive permit with a set of plans of what you really like to build, and then we knocking around.
I really wasn't at the point where I was designing a house. I was really at the point where I was trying to find out what my setbacks were, and I was really frustrated by that process enormously. And
so you weren't at the point of putting in a permit, building permit application?
Building permit? No, I'm not, I wasn't ready for a building permit. I wanted to know what the zoning parameters, so when I went to my architect, I could say, this is what the zoning parameters are. Let's build a house.
I see.
Okay, but I couldn't find that out, and so Wayne told me the only way to find that out was to apply for a permit, so that's what I did, and then my permit was denied. And I thought I had included all of the right things in the zoning that I wanted tested.
That's the kind of stuff that an architect bashes through.
I bashed through it. I spent a lot of time bashing through it, let me tell you.
And I personally think that that folks should be able to get through these processes. This particular one is, it is the definition of complicated.
But it was made more complicated by city officials who decided that they wanted to play games.
So there's, I would also caution that I understand you're frustrated, and that's probably an understatement. And I would caution you that we are, we've heard things you've been saying, and I'm not questioning all of the assumptions right now. We've been letting you speak. There's a lot of little details that could perhaps be clarified, and I see your next slide up is the cost of this appeal, which we can't hear that. So you can skip past that. And similar stuff about behavior that may or may not be reprehensible or opposable in court, all of those things you may have a case for. And for us, as the Zoning Board of Appeals, we have an appeal of an application. To me, it looks like when he said you need to go for an amendment of the comprehensive permit, am I correct that this is the ruling that you got dated October 15th?
This also
the ruling that I got 6th. I got after I submitted my appeal.
There's also an October 6th one here that lists three options. Is that what you're referring to?
No, I'm looking at, see, normally something gets appealed to zoning board of appeals.
No, I understand, but this is a separate.
That's an email.
It's either an email or a letter, probably an email. But are these not the options right now? I mean, I think the charge for the zoning board right now is whether or not to grant the appeal of the building commissioner's decision, which has to be a unanimous vote, right, to overturn it.
And I need to clarify exactly what was that decision.
Exactly, we will.
Okay.
But as I understand it, sir, and you may or may not have gotten this. I don't know. You know, I understand that there's been a lot of papers and emails flying furiously.
I'm familiar with everything. That's the email from Wayne that gives the three options.
That's right. Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So
I can see it from here.
Okay. See the highlights. Yeah.
So,
sure. It refers to what it talks about is it talks
no,
about.
No, it is not a decision.
He talks about the process. He's talking about process.
Right.
And he refers to the comprehensive permit application and the elevations. And he says there that those elevations don't show a garage. And they don't. But then he says it'll be okay. It's not a substantial change if you want to put the garage in the back. Which I don't understand either. It's a substantial change or it isn't. If it's permitted without a garage and you want to add a garage, that seems like a substantial change. But I think because a lot of the designs showed attached garages that he didn't want to do that. So he was like, if you put it in the back, it's okay.
Well, the comprehensive permit allows for some flexibility. I think you should stop looking at all those. It's just too confusing.
So I've got this letter from Lewis Hasbrook from November 5, 2015. And it says, I've reviewed the most recent zoning permit applications you submitted for a single family dwelling at 1 Garfield. I've conditionally approved these two proposals. you'll need to submit the documentation required by the homeowners association declarations and by the deed to the property before we start to review a building permit application. The homeowners association declarations require a plot plan for the lot, building plans, including drawings which show elevations, a description of exterior materials and colors, and the lot owner's proposed construction schedule. The property deed requires requirement that the grantee hire one of the licensed architects. I feel confident that I will be able to approve either of the two most recent proposals. The plans you have submitted don't show the degree of detail needed for an unqualified approval, but both seem reasonable. Feel free to contact me if you have any questions. Now, this is November 5, and it seems that you can just go ahead and move on to the next phase and submit a proposal now, right? To
those aren't ones that I want to build. Those are different ones.
You don't want to build those.
I don't want to build any of these.
Okay, so this.
We don't
this
have
is
to
completely
build any of them. We have to use the architect.
I understand that.
So the application.
What I'm saying is, if I sell the property, then I want to be able to legitimately tell them, yes, you can build this. So I want to have a permit for it.
You can't apply for someone else's permit.
I'm planning on selling the property. Sure.
So
you can't get someone else's permit. Yeah. The person who's building has to apply for the permit.
I understand that.
So this looks pretty good for
November 5. November 5. That's a good letter. I'm happy with that.
Okay,
letter.
So that's something
that
in your sales package for selling a lot. Here you have a letter that says it's possible to build something here. That's good. So, I need a sentence that what it is that the decision that you're appealing.
I'm appealing the decision that says that I don't have a right to put a garage in the place that I have it in that design.
Ah. Wow. Okay, thank you for
sorry, would you go through that again? You're saying that you're appealing a determination that there isn't that you can't put a garage right there. That's
correct.
That's the only thing you're appealing.
Right.
Okay.
Now, Well,
I was just sort of thinking again, sort of, I think that, you know, it's going to be very, very hard to overturn the zoning inspector's determination when there are so many things that we haven't seen that are necessary to the granting of the permit that haven't been supplied. In particular, these things that are required by the homeowner's declaration.
Yeah.
So, I mean, what I again think that you ought to do, and all of that, is to go through these various steps and resubmit it to Mr. Housbrook.
Can you clarify that the covenants are actually applicable by the city?
As far as I'm concerned, they are. Maybe a court will find it, but you know, I haven't seen this issue briefed. So I have no expertise sort of on that. Unless you show me some law that says that the homeowners association declarations are not pertinent to our determination, then I'm going to assume that they are.
Okay.
And also, if you're planning on selling it, the buyer may not want a garage.
They may not. See
that we can't make assumptions for what a buyer.
But I'm not saying that I'm not going to do it. It depends on what the determination is. You know, I need to know what you guys are going to do and how this project is going to move forward. I'm just saying that given the kind of interference and the excess cost that it's taking me just to find what the setbacks are, that this is going to be a cost prohibitive project. Look, I got $80,000 into this project. Those Habitat houses paid $0 for their land. I got to spend a lot of money to get my money back out of this.
You've got to understand sort of our limitations. All that we can do is either deny the appeal or grant the appeal.
Okay.
And since I don't know what you're really asking for, and all of that, it's going to be very, very hard for me to grant your appeal.
I said I'm asking whether I can have the right to put a garage in the front so that I do not need to have a long driveway, which will take away from the footprint of my house and reduce the value of my lot.
Okay, so
Can I just clarify a couple of things? So that request, that's a comprehensive permit amendment because that wasn't the original design. It was approved under the comprehensive permit. So if the garage wants to be in front, the applicant wants the garage in front, that would be another process. The setback issues were confusing at first.
It's
all throughout here,
please,
what the setbacks are on multiple pages in both the what was submitted under the building permit applications for the one thing that changed is the front. So it was originally 15, 10, 10, and 15, and it became 10, 10, 10, and 15 in the rear. And it's very clear, even through what Mr. Michael submitted, what those were, because there's a copy of the, that's in his copy of the comp permit amendment that showed what the setbacks were for lot one. So that was confusing up front, but it's been clarified even before he applied for.
I want to
but,
make sure.
But it's still referred.
I know. Yes. So this figure one, is this what went to with your application?
Yes.
So this is the one that shows a 250 square foot driveway. With
250 square foot.
Square feet, yes. And the garage coming up, and there's a little 15 foot. You could move it up to 10 feet, apparently. I'm not quite clear on this 4 foot number, but.
4 foot is the side yard setback for an accessory building.
Detached
accessory. So I think in the interest of trying to clarify what we can do for you.
Well, can you tell me whether this proposal meets objective zoning? That's one thing. Does it meet objective zoning permits? And
well, you know,
if it does, if it meets the objective zoning permits, does it meet the setbacks? That's one thing I want to know. If it does, then, and the only reason that the permit was denied was for harmonious reasons, and I would like you to have a better definition for me of what harmonious means.
It was denied because when we passed the comprehensive permit, we didn't allow a garage to be in front of the house. So what...
It didn't, the comprehensive permit didn't, was mute on garages.
Well,
And also the comprehensive permit clearly specified that lot one was different, that lot one was a market value lot, and that they were talking about those elevations for the three two-family homes for Habitat that weren't going to have garages. It didn't really say what lot one was going to be, because lot one was going to be a market value. And my opinion is that most of the other houses, the non-Habitat houses, 65% of them have garages, okay? And you can force me to put the garage in the back, but I don't think that makes any sense. You know, you go down the street and you look at those garages that are all the way in the back and they're falling apart.
So what do we need to do to make a garage in front?
If an amendment of the comp permit is
On the comp permit, though. Mm-hmm. So it's on the comprehensive permit that you can't have a garage in front.
So where?
It doesn't say that. It has a design for the units that would be part of the cluster, the overall cluster, which was approved as part of the whole comprehensive permit.
And
so those concept designs show covered front entry facing the street. And at the time, there were also, in the zoning at the time, there was a lot of discussion about where garages can go on the lot. So it was in that frame where you have houses that front the street creates that street frontage in that neighborhood. Character.
Those were all for
the
Habitat.
The
those were all for the Habitat buildings.
Wait a minute, that's true.
The building commissioner was just doing what we authorized in our comprehensive permit. And so what you would need to do, what he did was exactly right. What you need to do, if you want to continue...
No, he waited until after I...
What you want to do, if you want to continue, is bring, ask for permission from us to reconfigure the comprehensive permit. That's what needs to be done at this point.
I understand that, but I believe that the same thing should happen should I choose to put a garage in the rear. And I think I should also have to amend the comprehensive permit, because there is no specification for any garage. So adding any garage to this makes it a substantial change.
So at this point, your application in front of us, the only thing that we can possibly rule on is whether or not he was wrong. What I would rather be ruling on is if you put in an application to amend your comprehensive permit, then we could act on something for you.
Yeah.
And I look forward to that.
Yeah.
Because part of, as you know, part of the philosophy of this was showing some flexibility in being able to build something small on a small lot. And we'd like to be able to help you do that. But what we can, the only thing in front of us right now is whether
you
or not
have to make that
wrong.
Determination only based on the information that I received when I submitted my appeal. And that excludes that second September 23rd letter. You can only include the first letter, which only says...
We don't even particularly, I mean, the fact there's so many applications in the air, and I don't have applications numbered 1 through 9 saying, okay, this is my number. No, I don't want them. They're not pertinent to this.
What I want specifically to be pertinent is that the appeal that I'm making is applicable to the documents that were in effect at the time. I don't want to be having you taking documents that were produced after my appeal application and incorporating them into the discussion about whether this should be approved or not.
We're not approving your permit application.
I understand that.
Okay. All we're doing is
making a determination of his determination.
Whether or not he was wrong.
Yeah.
And in his now he's making a decision in a complicated and, as you found, confusing whole arena. And if his so far, what he was working with at the time, and I must admit, all of the other stuff has confused me a bit to sort out exactly what he was making the offensive determination on. So for us to, you see what I'm saying? Try to rephrase, or you rephrase for me?
Well, look, but one thing, I don't think that we can give an opinion as to whether the zoning allows for there to be a garage in front.
Correct,
I mean,
we cannot.
Because
we
that
can't
issue
determine that
wasn't
here.
Really
right.
Before.
Right. Not now.
So the issue is, has the building inspector given cogent and sufficient reasons for denying the application? And I notice from the thing of November 5th that there is, again, a statement that in order to be sort of approved, that there must be, and I'm looking at page 3 of the Homeowners Association Declaration of Restricted Easements and Covenant. And it seems quite clear that you have not satisfied the requirements of paragraph 4, building approval. and that is that no building or other structure should be commenced or erected, nor should any addition be made until plans or specifications showing the nature, kind, shape, height, material, floor plans, exterior color screen, and the grading plan of the lot to be built upon have been submitted and have been approved in writing by the developer or by the city in recordable form. The developer of the city shall have the right to refuse or to approve any such plans or specification that are not suitable or desirable in its opinion. It doesn't even say that any other person gets to make a determination. It sort of says the city in its opinion. Correct. Or not suitable or desirable. So I guess, I mean, we haven't sort of taken our time to discuss it, but I can't approve your appeal given that you have not taken the elementary steps that are necessary to receive a building permit according to the governing document.
Except that the problem was that I wasn't notified of those things until after I filed the appeal. I was not notified. I was only given that one letter without any supporting documentation, and then I was told I'll communicate with you by letter. And I received nothing for months at a time, or 6 weeks, 5 weeks.
I understand your frustration. Right now, you can actually move ahead and do what you need to do to either build a property, build on a property, or sell the property. It may require that you come back to us to revise the comprehensive permit, but I can't see myself voting against you building with a garage in front in this place. I can't see that. But I also can't see myself overturning any decision that the building inspector has made or building commissioner has made because he has been following the rules of the comprehensive permit. He hasn't made any mistakes. Okay, thank you.
Hoping it's clear, but I think I'd like to either close the public hearing if we think we have enough information, or a motion to continue the discussion if we think we need more information about the building inspector's decision.
Should we hear from the building inspector?
That's what she's saying. We would have to move up to another place or else continue to another time.
We could continue our hearing, our open public hearing, if we want to hear from the building commissioner, or we can close our public hearing if we feel like we have enough information, with knowing the procedures that the vote would have to be unanimous to overturn his decision.
Can I make a comment?
Yes.
Is it possible to do something like a continuance so that I could get through the process, as you said, of achieving all the things that Lewis has asked me for and get through that process and put this appeal on hold until the next meeting or something like that, I'll try to work with Lewis to get together the things that I need to do that.
If you would like to withdraw your appeal of his decision on this particular piece of this particular application of yours.
I don't want to withdraw, I just want to suspend until I can. If I had been given that information on September 30th before I filed the appeal, then I would have done the due diligence to have done that, had that done, and it would have been all done and prepared by now. But I didn't have that opportunity because I didn't get it before I filed.
You're not interested in withdrawing your appeal with or without prejudice?
No.
But you'd like to continue?
I'd like to have a continuance on it.
Well, I don't think I've heard enough.
Procedural.
I was just going to say, from the beginning, we've always described what the process was and what the various paths were and why things weren't approved and what could be approved. So that's always been on the table. But what's in front of you is an appeal of one item. So going back before the building commissioner with another application is really just a separate path that doesn't have any bearing on what's in front of you. So I strongly recommend that you go ahead, if you feel like you've heard enough information, close and make a decision on that, rather than leaving this open because it's a completely separate path anyway.
And then he can just go and do it.
It doesn't have any bearing on any future application or process because he couldn't amend this process with another thing that's happened afterwards anyway.
Okay.
What we're saying is that, let me summarize, and board members, correct me if I'm wrong, but you are free to put in another permit application. It could be a building permit application for a particular architect design. It could be an application to amend the comprehensive permit.
For zoning?
Right.
Yes, zoning board permit is required under an amendment of comprehensive permit. And that amendment, what you'd be requesting is what you actually want to do or what you would like the comprehensive permit to look like to keep your flexibility for your own project or someone else's. But that doesn't, we're really only interested, we can only rule on this one issue on this one particular permit application.
And the easiest thing for you to do?
Based on the way the comprehensive permit is currently written. So you would be free to do any other
What is the impact of that? I don't understand. If I apply for putting a garage in there as a part of a new application, and can't you just come back and say, oh, we've already denied a garage there, and you're gone?
No. You'd be asking us to amend the comprehensive permit for a garage.
Which is a part of the process that hasn't been considered yet.
And
the easiest way for you to do that would be to just withdraw this because request to overturn the building commissioner's opinion, because it doesn't even have to go to that point at this point.
If you're concerned that this decision is res judicata, I don't know if that
the decision
is right. If this decision is res judicata to a future request to amend the comprehensive permit, that's not going to be the case. I don't know if you've heard those
that
words.
That is what I'm worried about.
Okay, so the answer to that is no. So you can go ahead with the comprehensive permit. I know that you mentioned Attorney Hill before, and this was some of your concern. But you can withdraw this, proceed on amending the comprehensive permit. The decision today were to uphold the decision of the building commissioner has no effect on your right to request the amendment of the comprehensive permit or on the zoning board's ability to act on that. This will not, any decision today against you on this appeal doesn't affect their decision, the zoning board's decision at a future time on a comprehensive permit amendment.
That may be very similar to this.
Yes.
That's true, even if we were to deny your appeal tonight, it would still be true that there would be nothing determinative. That would not be an authoritative finding that a garage can't be put in front of there. All we're doing, again, is just ratifying
But if you're concerned about that, then I think we should take a vote, and that would be appealable were to become necessary and preserve any concerns you have about any statute of limitations or exhaustion or res judicata. So
what was the one before that? Exhaustion?
Yeah.
Is that running out?
It's illegal.
Running out of your time.
Because I feel exhausted.
Okay. Yeah, we are all.
Can I come in and just, I wanted to talk.
I'm sorry, we're going to, you can.
I thought you wanted to, me to make a decision on what I wanted to do with this.
We're going to close the public hearing, I believe.
Did you want me to withdraw? I mean, that's what I'm wondering, if that, whatever the best, whatever is best as far as.
I think it'd be easiest.
You satisfied my concern, I'm sorry, Ms. Silver, you satisfied my major concern, okay? And so that makes me much happier, and I'm willing to proceed in any way that you guys feel like it's best for you.
Personally, it seems to be claimed that it would be cleaner if we just heard this appeal, got it out of the way, and then you could start over again with the.
Withdrawing is best.
I would say it's best, you're deciding on whether the building commissioner erred or not. So that's before you. That's your question.
So is it okay for him to withdraw if he wishes?
I think it's okay for him to withdraw.
Yeah, I think so.
So sir, you can withdraw if you wish, or we will close public hearing and make it.
Well, you'd have to vote either way to accept the withdrawal or close the hearing.
So.
Right.
I'll withdraw.
Okay, I make a motion that we accept the applicant's request for a withdrawal.
A second.
All in favor?
Thank you very much.
A motion on the hearing?
Sorry for the contention.
No, we're also.
We're still an open hearing here?
Sure. I move that we close the hearing.
I do that too. Yeah, backwards.
All in favor? Public hearing is closed. Thank you all.
Yeah.
Motion to adjourn. Second.